Hi everybody. First of all, I want to thank the organizer to allow me to participate to this conference. And today I will discuss my work on accidental dark matter in HPLS. So let's start. And we know from astrophysical and cosmological data that about one-fourth of our universe is composed by dark matter. And we know the main properties of dark matter, that is, it must be a neutral particle, stable or at least very long-lived. Cold, which means non relativistic at the time of structure formation, and weakly interacting with the standard model particles. And to satisfy all these requirements, we need some new physics beyond the standard model. But let's go back to the standard model for a moment, and let's consider the proton. And we all know that the proton is stable, or at least its lifetime is very, very, very long. And why? Well, this is just a consequence. An accidental symmetry of the renormalizable standard model Lagrangian, which is the Bayer number, a U1 global symmetry, which arises as a consequence of gauge invariance. Therefore, the proton, being the lightest baryon, is automatically stable in the standard model. Of course, it could decay if we allow for higher dimensional operators, which break the Bayer number, but since they are suppressed by some cutoff scale of the theory, their effect is tiny and the proton is still very long-lived, even in their presence. So the natural question we can ask is, can dark matter be an accidentally stable state as the proton? And in general, the answer is yes. What we need is, first of all, a dark sector, and we can think of as a confining or a spontaneously broken dark gauge theory, such that gauge invariance naturally leads to a set of accidental global symmetries of the action, at least up to a certain dimension. Such that the lightest state with non-trivial transformation properties under this symmetry is automatically stable and can be identified with the dark matter candidate of the model. Of course, if we allow for generic higher dimensional operators, they will break the accidental symmetries at some dimension, but if this happens with dimension large enough, then the dark matter is allowed to decay, but with some decay rate, which is highly suppressed by powers of the cutoff scale, such that the dark matter lifetime can still be very, very long and satisfy the experimental constraints. So that's the general framework. In this talk, I will discuss these free gauge groups. And as we know, a gauge theory contains some vectors in the joint representation, plus a set of additional fermion or scalar fields in arbitrary representations. So what are the most general accidental symmetries we can find out in gauge theories? Well, we have global U1 numbers, which acts as a rephasing of the matter fields. And this is exactly the same of the baryon number, but within the dark sector, and such that the lightest particle charge under this U1 is automatically stable, and of course must be complex. We can have group parity, which is a Z2 symmetry, which acts as a reflection group space around one of the n equivalent directions, where n is the number of dark colors. And now the lightest Z2 odd state is therefore stable. Or we can have group charge conjugation, which is again a Z2 symmetry, which is naturally defined as an Lagrangian by flipping the sign of gauge vectors and taking their conjugates. But it can be extended also to other groups and other representations, such that again, the lightest Z2 odd state is automatically stable. So a few words about dark matter production. So there are many possible mechanisms to product dark matter abundance in the early universe. Here I show the simplest one, which is thermal production of this out. So the idea is simple. Dark matter is initially in thermal equilibrium with the standard model bath. And equilibrium is kept by annihilation processes such as the one I show in this figure, where chi is the dark matter particle. And they occur with some interaction rate proportional to the dark matter number density and dark matter annihilation cross-section. At the same time, the universe is expanding with some rate given by Hubble. And when the dark matter particle becomes non-relativistic, which occurs roughly when the temperature of the thermal bath is of the order of the dark matter mass, the interaction rate gets an exponential suppression. And at some point, it becomes smaller than the Hubble rate, such that the dark matter particle decouples from the thermal bath and its number is conserved until today. So we can define a useful quantity, which is the ratio of the number density of dark matter and entropy density, which follow an equilibrium distribution at early times, here in red, And at decoupling, it freezes and stays constant. And from that, we can compute the relic abundance of dark matter. So we can apply now this to scalar gauge theories. So we consider a new dark gauge group, G, one among these three, with a scalar field in the fundamental representation and singlet of the standard model. We work at the normalizable level, so we write down the most general Lagrangian. And as you can see, the dark sector is connected to the standard model through the interaction term between the new scalar and the standard model X field. And this is usually known as X portal. And we also work under the additional assumption of scale invariance, which practically means that the quadratic terms in the action are zero. And that therefore, all the scale relevant scales of the model, including the weak scale, can be generated dynamically, and the model becomes much more predictive. Okay, this kind of models admit two apparently different phases. In the X phase, the scalar field gets a vacuum expectation value at some scale, and the gauge group gets spontaneously broken to some subgroup, H, which in general is non-abelian and confines at some smaller energy scale, such that after confinement, the asymptotic states in this phase must be singlet of the unbroken gauge group H. And in particular, if in the scale invariance hypothesis, symmetry breaking occurs dynamically a la Coleman-Weinberg. Instead, if we are in the confined phase, the scalar verb is zero, but then scalar condensate can form, such that we have no more symmetry breaking, but the full gauge group G gets strongly coupled and confines at some scale lambda. And this is analogous to what happens in QCD, for example, such that in this phase, the asymptotic states of the theory must be singlet of the full gauge group G. And they point out that in principle, the asymptotic states in the two phases can be very, very different. Usually they are composite states and even their constituents can be completely different. But there is a theorem by Radkin and Schenker that proved that for SU2 gauge group with a fundamental scalar, the two phases are actually smoothly connected in the sense that we can always move from one phase to another in the parameter space in a smooth way. Or in other words, there is no phase transition which divides them. And in particular, they share the same spectrum of asymptotic particles and the same unbroken accidental global symmetries. So our question is, can we generalize the statement to more general groups? And our claim is yes. Actually, we claim a duality among the X and the confined phase of the theory whenever the scalar field is the fundamental representation of our gauge groups. And our claim is based on the one-to-one mapping of the asymptotic states and the accidental symmetries among the two phases. In particular, in this table, I show for each group the spectrum of asymptotic particles in both phases, and you can easily see the one-to-one correspondence, which I point out is based on the quantum numbers of the states, both the spin and the internal quantum numbers under the accidental symmetries. And a similar table also if we look for the unbroken accidental symmetries in the two phases. And these properties are hard to explain in presence of a phase transition, which instead would require some discontinuity between the two phases. Of course, this is not a proof. This is, if you want, a strong indication of a possible duality will be a very indistinct properties of this kind of models. But of course, further study is required to confirm this. For example, lattice computation could be useful. So now we can move to the dark matter phenomenology. So using the duality, we work in the X phase, which is easier. So the gauge group gets spontaneously broken, such that we get in the spectrum a light scalar particle, which plays the role of dark X, plus a set of massless massive vectors, which acquire mass through the symmetry breaking. Then we have gauge confinement, and the particles combine into a singlet of the unbroken gauge groups, such that most of them are composite particles made of these massless or massive vectors. In particular, one or more of these states will be stable because of the accidental symmetries of the Lagrangian and can be identified with dark matter. So all in all, dark matter is an accidentally stable composite particle with a mass given either by the confinement scale or by the scale of spontaneous symmetry breaking. So in this table, I show for each group the accidental global symmetries of the Lagrangian, which stabilizes dark matter, and the dark matter candidates. And as you can see, for different groups, we have very different objects, and they are always bound states of made of elementary particles. So dark matter is produced thermally, and the annihilation cross-section can be estimated as geometrical or Bohr-like, depending on the hierarchies between the scales. And here I show the parameter space. In the axis, I have the confinement scale versus the scale of spontaneous symmetry breaking. And the dark matter abundance is reproduced along the boundaries between the green and the red regions. And in particular, I also show constraints from direct and indirect searches and cosmology. And as you can see in the interesting region of the parameter space, the model is still unconstrained. Finally, a few words about phenomenology. There are many possible signatures. Here I show two examples. The first one is Dirac detection, that is elastic scattering of dark matter particles on target nuclei. This is mediated at three levels by the exchange of a light scalar, such that the spin-independent cross-section is proportional to the x-portal coupling. Furthermore, the light scalar itself is a good signature, is a characteristic signature of this model, and it can be produced at colliders thanks to its mixing with the standard model X boson at the Lagrangian level. In particular, here I show the prediction for the scalar production cross-section in units of the standard model X production cross-section. And as you can see, future colliders with a higher precision along this axis could be able to test a significant region of the parameter space. And finally, I want to point out that we also studied models with scalar field in the two index representation of a gauge group. And we found that almost always we can find one or more accidental dark matter particles, while we find no generic dualities among the different phases. So we can say that dark matter is always there in scalar gauge theories, but the duality seems to be a property of the fundamental representation. In the last part of the talk, I will discuss an axiom model, which is, however, connected to the previous part, as we will see. So I begin with a brief overview on axioms. So we know that the QCD Lagrangian contains a CP-validating term, which is known as theta term, and predicts an electric dipole moment for the neutron. But experimental measurements constrain theta to be really, really tiny, and this is known as Strong CP problem. The most famous solution is the one of Peccei-Quinn, in which they introduce a new chiral U1 global symmetries, which is now known as Peccei-Quinn symmetry, which must be both spontaneously broken at some scale f and anomalous under QCD interactions, such that we get a new light scalar particle in the spectrum, the axion, and the axion potential has this form, and there's a minimum for this combination equal to zero, which means that the axion web cancels the theta term and restores the CP symmetry. Or in other words, we are replacing the static theta term with a dynamical degrees of freedom, the axion, which relaxes to the CP invariant minimum. So everything works fine and simple, but now we have to take into account the effects of new physics. You can think, for example, explicitly on gravity. Indeed, the Peccei-Quinn symmetry is a global symmetry, so it's not expected to be a fundamental symmetry of nature like gauge symmetries, but rather to be an accidental symmetry of the low energy dynamics. And therefore it is expected to be broken by physics at higher energies. And this Peccei-Quinn breaking physics will in general give extra contribution to the axion potential, which is going to misalign the minimum, such that this condition here is no longer satisfied, and we have CP violation again. And this is known as Peccei-Quinn quality problem. So we must-
You have 5 minutes.
Okay. We must assure that even in presence of new physics which breaks the Peccei-Quinn symmetry, the axion web satisfies this condition, which is nothing but the experimental constraints on theta parameter. In the following, we will parameterize new physics with non-normalizable operators suppressed by some cutoff scale. So that's our model. We consider an S1 gauge group with a scalar field in the symmetric representation and singlet under the standard model, which is one of the models we have already studied in the context of scalar gauge dynamics. And we now add some new fermions, which I show in this table, which are charged under both the standard model gauge group and S2N, and they provide an accidental pre-checkpoint symmetry at the normalizable level. The symmetry is spontaneously broken together with the S1 gauge group by the scalar web to SON, such that we get an axiom field and an axiom scale. And we find that the model is also invariant under an accidental group parity, which is also preserved by the unbroken S1 dynamics, which of course gets strongly coupled and confines some smaller scale lambda. So now we allow for high dimensional operators, and we look for the first, for the lowest dimensional operator, which can break the Pre-checkpoint symmetry. And we find that this arises only at dimension n. We compute the contribution to the axiom potential and found the minimum. And we find that the Pre-checkpoint quality problem is successfully solved if this condition on the Pre-checkpoint scale f and the number of dark colors n is satisfied. And they plot the condition on the fn plane for different choices of the cutoff scale. In particular, in the red region, we have a Pre-checkpoint quality problem, while in the rest of the plane, this is solved. And they also show constraints from cosmology, VBN in blue, and Landau poles in gray. And there are always some region on the parameter space in which all the constraints are satisfied. I want to point out that the reason why this Pre-checkpoint breaking operators arises only at dimension n is precisely gauge invariance. Because the lowest dimensional operators are forbidden by gauge invariance. So we can say that gauge invariance in this model not only leads to an accidental Pre-checkpoint symmetry, but also to the solution of the Pre-checkpoint quality problem in a simple way. So now we can focus in the good region of the parameter space and we can study the phenomenology. Indeed, the model predicts multi-component accidental dark matter. We have, first of all, axions, which are good dark matter particles, and they are produced through the usual alignment mechanism. And then we have some composite Bout states, which emerge from SON dynamics. And some of them are odd under the accidental group parity, and therefore the lightest odd state is accidentally stable and can be produced thermally with geometrical annihilation cross-section. And here I show the parameter space in two cases, if the Pre-checkpoint symmetry is broken before or after the end of inflation. And the axis, I have the Pre-checkpoint scale and the confinement scale of SON. And again, the dark matter abundance is reproduced along the boundaries between the green and the red regions. And in the most part of the parameter space, the constraints are satisfied. Axions have a coupling with photons. This coupling is constrained by the requirement to avoid charge and colored relics, such that in the end, we can have only three possible values, which I show here compared to the experimental constraints and some future perspective on this coupling. So finally, I will go through my conclusions. We saw that a new dark gauge sector provides a set of accidental global symmetries, which naturally leads to automatically stable dark matter candidates. We apply this framework to scalar gauge theories, and we claim a duality among the different phases of the theory whenever the scalar field is the fundamental representation of the gauge group. And we found that these models also provide the accidental composite dark matter for both the fundamental and high order representations. Finally, we studied the S1 gauge model with one scalar field and some fermions, which provides an accidental Pre-checkpoint symmetry automatically preserved by a higher dimensional operator, such that gauge invariance leads to the solution of both the strong CP problem and the Pre-checkpoint quality problem. And furthermore, it also gives multi-component accidental dark matter candidates. And that's all, and thank you for the question.
Okay, thank you very much. The session is open to questions, comments. Yes, please, Fabio.
Yes, I have a question on the starting assumptions of your models of scalar gauge dynamics. What's the basis for assuming scale invariant, which is neither an accidental symmetry of your Lagrangian nor quantum symmetry of your model, because it's explicitly broken by quantum corrections? And the follow-up that I say immediately is, would the introduction of a mass term for the scalars spoil the conclusions of your investigation?
Okay, thank you for the question. Actually, here we work under this assumption for convenience, because the model becomes more predictive, because you have less free parameters. But actually, we also studied what can change if we introduce a mass term. And actually, the main conclusion are not affected. Then there are two main differences. One is the existence of more free parameters of the theory. So you gain in the sense that the theory becomes more general, but you lose in predictivity. And one of the consequences are that the light scalar, which emerges from the symmetry breaking, if we assume scale invariance, takes mass only at one loop level. Therefore, it's significantly lighter than the other states, while introducing a three-level mass, of course, this particle will have a three-level mass, and there are some differences in the phenomenology. For example, there is a suppression of the Dirac detection cross-section due to this larger mass, while, for example, the cosmology of the model is not affected significantly because this scalar particle plays a minor role in cosmology. So we can say that the conclusion are not so much affected. There are some differences, of course, but I mean, not qualitatively, I would say.
Thank you.
I don't know if this replies.
Elisa, you are muted.
Sorry. Okay, I see a raised hand by Andrea Cappelli.
Yeah, yes. In which sense you say that in your theory, when you have a scalar in the fundamental, scalar fields, matter field in the fundamental, the Higgs phase and the confined phase are dual?
Yeah, the idea.
What do you mean by dual?
Yeah, by dual, I mean that actually there is no phase transition which divide them, but we can move to one phase to another in a smooth way. Basically, that's the idea. Of course, this requires some more detailed computation. For example, for SU2, this has been proved with lattice computations some times ago. Here, we make a claim just looking at the asymptotic states and the unbroken accidental symmetries of two phases. And in particular, repeat here. It's easy to see the correspondence between the states. Actually, you can even start from the states in the confined phase, decompose them in multiplets of the unbroken gauge group, and you can directly derive the states in the X phase. Of course, I repeat, this is not a proof, this is just a level of claim. But I mean, the important point would be the for dark matter phenomenology, for example, that you can take the result from the X phase and extend them also to part of the parameter space where the two is strongly coupled, basically. That's the idea.
Yeah, but why you call it a duality? It's the same theory. And beside that, it's also the same phase, after all.
The same phase because you don't have a phase transition in it. Yeah. Actually, we take the name by the original paper here by Fredkin and Schenker, but Dwight, I just mean that basically there is no phase transition. I would expect a phase transition between them while I didn't observe this, basically. I just want to say that. I don't know if this is the more precise word, maybe not.
Yes, I think that nowadays duality means that you have the same theory described by different sets of fields, which in general, they are not perturbatively related the one to the other. But this is not the case in this theory, it seems to me. So the use of word duality, I find maybe.
Okay. Maybe it's not, maybe it's not the better word to use. Yeah. Okay.
So I think we can conclude also third talk. Okay, and yes.
Sorry, I raised my hand.
Okay, sure. Sorry. I couldn't see all the hands at the same time.
No, please. A very short question, which is related to the question by Fabio. Actually, as he said, the scale invariance is not an accidental symmetry. And then also your answer. You can choose if you consider or not a three-level value for the mass of scalars, and then of course the consequences are different for the two models. Mm-hmm. So my question, if you want, is a little bit more general. It could be useful just to try to figure out a theory from which all the these consequences are can be derived. I mean, if you consider a three-level scalar or not, of course the differences are for the predictions are huge, no? So for having a fundamental scalar with mass brings with these assumptions also other problems, naturalness, if you want, the way in which you can keep this mass small. So have you asked yourself?
Indeed, one of the motivation, maybe I forgot, one of the motivation of scale invariance is also, we took this from a previous paper by Ambai and Strumia, which they used to predict the weak scale. They generated the weak scale exactly by means of a scalar gauge theory, by means of dynamical effects, so as to solve naturalness problems and so on. So if you want, this is also a generalization of this kind of theory, which was already present in the literature. Of course, the generation of the weak scale by dynamical effects is another motivation, if you want, for this assumption, yes.